In the last lecture, we discussed the second law of thermodynamics. We learned about irreversible and reversible processes. We also learned the concept of a heat engine, and we found that the Carnot heat engine has maximum efficiency of all heat engines. No real heat engine can exceed or even approach the efficiency of the Carnot heat engine. In this lecture, we start with oscillations and waves. In the first few lectures, we shall deal with oscillations, and later on, we will take on waves. So, what is an oscillation? When a system moves about its equilibrium position on one side and the other, or up and down, the system is said to execute oscillations or vibrations. An oscillation, a single oscillation if we talk of, consists of the passage of the system through a given position such as O. You look at this diagram, this position O, the system goes up, goes down and goes through O again. This is said to constitute one oscillation. If the time taken for each oscillation is constant, then the oscillations are said to be periodic. A simple pendulum, I hope you all know, executes periodic oscillations. The time period of a pendulum, let me remind you, say if we start from point P, P to O, O to B, B back to A and then to P. This constitutes one oscillation, and the period or the time taken by this oscillation is called the time period. The displacement from the mean position of the system to an extreme position, say A or B, is said to be its amplitude. Usually, there is little friction at the point of suspension, and the oscillations continue for a long time without any decrease in the amplitude. If there is a lot of friction at this point, at the point of suspension, or due to air surrounding the pendulum, then the amplitude of the oscillations decreases and stops oscillating after some time. Oscillations in which the amplitude decreases progressively are called damped oscillations. After the initial displacement of the bob, there is no periodic force acting on the pendulum to make it vibrate. You see, it is vibrating on its own. There is no force which is forcing it to do that. Oscillations without a driving force are called free or natural oscillations. It must be remembered that the time period and frequency of free oscillations is a characteristic of the system. For example, a simple pendulum of a given length and a given place has always the same time period. An important thing to remember is that a system can oscillate only about a position of stable equilibrium. As you might be knowing, a system is said to be in stable equilibrium if it comes back to its original position after it is slightly disturbed from the position. Stable equilibrium is the position of minimum potential energy. In this example, this red dot in this bowl indicates the position of stable equilibrium. If you displace this ball slightly, then it starts oscillating. On the other hand, this point P is the position of unstable equilibrium. That is, if you disturb the ball slightly from this position, then it goes on and does not come back to the position P. It actually gains kinetic energy at the cost of the potential energy, and no oscillations are possible in this case. One of the simplest motions which can be treated also exactly mathematically is called simple harmonic motion, or simply SHM. It is represented by a sine wave or a cosine wave or a combination of the two waves. As an oscillating particle goes up and down or to and fro, its position is plotted along a line as the time progresses. This particle goes up and down along this straight line, and its position at any given time is plotted along this time axis. So, when the particle is here, its position is here. When the particle is here, its position is here. When the particle is here, its position is here or here. You see, so as the particle goes up and down, we plot its position along a timeline, and we get a curve of this kind, which is either a sine curve or a time curve or a cosine curve. And you see the time period is from this point to this point, and this the position of the maximum displacement from the mean position is the amplitude of the oscillation. When its amplitude is small, oscillations of a simple pendulum are almost simple harmonic. Oscillations of a spring loaded with a mass in this system, for example, are also simple harmonic in nature. Even those oscillations which do not look like the sine curves can be broken up into a combination of simple harmonic motions. That is why it is important to study simple harmonic motion. The general equation of a simple harmonic motion is y equal to a sin omega t plus theta, or y equal to a cos omega t plus theta, where y is the displacement at any time t, a is the amplitude, and omega is the angular speed or angular frequency of oscillations. This term omega t plus theta, which is the argument of sine or cosine, is called the phase of the oscillation, and theta is the phase constant. It is a phase at time t equal to 0. If the particle initially is at an extreme position, that is A or B, the displacement then is maximum, and theta in sine omega t plus theta is plus minus pi by 2. You see, sine of omega t plus pi by 2 gives at t equal to 0. If theta is pi by 2, it gives you sine pi by 2 equal to 1. So, you get position A or B. If the particle is at the mean position initially, that is either at O or Q, then theta is either 0 or pi. Again, remind ourselves that the equation of a simple harmonic oscillation is y equal to a sin omega t plus theta. And as I have been saying, at time t equal to 0, if the particle is at O, then theta is equal to 0, because then sin 0 is 0. If initially it is at A, then theta is pi by 2, because then sin pi by 2 is 1, and like that. Remember that sine or cosine functions are periodic functions. Their period is 2 pi, that is sin omega t is equal to sin omega t plus 2 pi, that every 2 pi the sine function repeats itself. Now, if the motion is repeated after every interval of time t, then sin omega t is sin omega t plus t, because it recovers its value after time t. We say that t is the time period of the motion, and if you compare these two, you will see that t must be equal to, in terms of angle, equal to 2 pi. So, the time period may be expressed in terms of the angle, or the angle may be expressed in terms of the time period. Phase may also be expressed in terms of the time period. For example, a phase difference of pi is equivalent to t by 2. The angular speed is related to the time period t, as omega is 2 pi by t, and 1 by t is nu, therefore it is 2 pi nu, and nu is the frequency of the oscillations. Omega is the angular frequency of oscillations, and if we use this omega equal to 2 pi nu, then the equation of SHM can be written y equal to a sin 2 pi by t into t. Now, the velocity of the system executing SHM is v equal to dy by dt, and if you differentiate sine, you will get cosine. So, it will be a omega cosine omega t plus theta, which can also be written as plus minus omega into a square minus y square. If we use cos theta equal to 1 minus sin square theta, you can write in this form, showing that velocity is 0 when y is equal to plus minus a. When y is plus minus a, this vanishes and v is equal to 0. So, that is at extreme positions, v is equal to 0. The acceleration of the system is a, which is now dv by dt or d2y by dt square, and which we get by differentiating this. When you differentiate cos, you will get a minus sign. So, minus omega squared a into sin omega t plus theta. And remember, a sin omega t plus theta is y. Therefore, a is equal to minus omega squared y. This is the key equation which defines SHM. Whenever we are asked to recognize a motion as SHM, we shall look for this equation. That is, the acceleration is equal to minus omega squared y. That is, acceleration is in the opposite direction to displacement and it is equal to omega squared y. The acceleration of the particle is proportional to its displacement, but is in the opposite direction. That is the signature of a motion which is simple harmonic. We also say that the force is proportional to displacement, because acceleration is force divided by mass, so one could say that. And that is also the statement of Hooke's law. When we compress or stretch a spring or displace the bob of a pendulum from its mean position, a restoring force develops in these systems, which tends to pull the system back to the original position. That is, if I have a spring and I press it or extend it, then if I leave it, it goes back and starts oscillating. That is, if I extend it, then a restoring force comes into play, which when I leave it, pushes it in the opposite direction. It is this restoring force or acceleration caused by this restoring force that is proportional to the displacement, and it is in the direction opposite to it. We have already seen that the equation for acceleration is equal to a minus omega squared y, and this can be written as d2y by dt square plus omega squared y equal to 0, which is a second order differential equation, which has a general solution y equal to a sin omega t plus theta. From this equation, we get v, which is a omega cos omega t plus theta. And you see, this is sin, this is cos, so there is a phase difference of pi by 2. So, we see that displacement and velocity are out of phase by pi by 2. When the displacement is maximum, that is omega t plus theta equal to pi by 2, velocity is 0, because cosine of pi by 2 is 0. Similarly, when displacement is 0, velocity is maximum, because then cos 0 is equal to 1. Here I show you the displacement and velocity, and you see they are out of phase. This is displacement and this is velocity. You can see when the velocity is 0, displacement is maximum. When this velocity is maximum, displacement is 0. So, this is a phase difference of pi by 2, not pi, but pi by 2. You see, it is maximum and this is 0. It is 0, it is maximum. So, there is a phase difference of pi by 2. Again, I show the phase difference between displacement and velocity. You can see there is a phase difference of pi by 2. And the acceleration is, here it is maximum, here it is minimum. Here it is minimum, here it is maximum. So, the phase difference between displacement and acceleration is pi. If it is maximum here, it is minimum here. If it is minimum here, it is maximum here. So, they have a phase difference of pi by 2, velocity and displacement. Velocity and acceleration also have a phase difference of pi by 2, and the phase difference between displacement and acceleration is pi. Again, the same thing, acceleration lags in phase by pi by 2 compared with velocity, and velocity is ahead of displacement by pi by 2. So, there is a phase difference of pi by 2 here, and the total phase difference between this and this, that is displacement and acceleration, is pi. A pendulum bob has maximum velocity, you know, when it is at the mean position. If you fix the zero of potential energy here, the total energy at the mean position is equal to half mv squared, because potential energy is 0. When it goes to the extreme position, then the kinetic energy is 0, because v is 0, and the only energy it has then is the potential energy. And this potential energy is because this bob is slightly raised with respect to the bob in the mean position, and this energy is mgh. So, the total energy is either mgh at the extreme position or equal to half mv squared at the mean position, and it keeps on changing in between, the sum remains constant. Here I show you this, the kinetic energy varies as this, potential energy varies as this, but the sum of two is always constant. The sum of kinetic and potential energies can always be written as half m a squared omega squared, where a is of course the amplitude, omega is the angular frequency, and m is the mass of the system. Let us take a few examples to clarify these concepts. Example 1, what is the phase constant delta in a cos omega t plus delta if the position of the oscillating particle at time t equal to 0 is 0? So, let us see the solution. At time t equal to 0, 0 is equal to cos delta, that is delta must be equal to pi by 2. The equation of motion is then x equal to a cos omega t plus pi by 2, which is equal to sin omega t. We see that both sine and cosine functions represent SHM. In fact, any combination of sine and cosine functions can represent the simple harmonic motion. I have here a very complicated displacement, y equal to sin omega t plus pi by 3, 2 cos omega t minus pi by 8, I mean arbitrarily written, a combination of sine and cosine functions. And you see that the combination is a harmonic oscillation. Take example 2. A particle executes simple harmonic motion with an amplitude A. The period of oscillation is t. Find the minimum time taken by the particle to travel half of the amplitude from the equilibrium position. So, we write y equal to a sin 2 pi by t into t. So, at y equal to 0, t is equal to 0, because then sin 2 pi by t into t is 0, therefore, t is equal to 0. At y equal to a by 2, we have a by 2 equal to a sin 2 pi by into t. And if I cancel a from both sides, it becomes half equal to sin 2 pi by t into t. And from this, because sin 2 pi by t, the sine function is equal to half only when this is equal to, when this argument is equal to 30 degrees, that is pi by 6. So, 2 pi by t into t equal to pi by 6, and from this we can find out t. And this t turns out to be t by 12. That is, it takes 1/12 of the total time period for the particle to cover only half the amplitude. We could have arrived at this result simply by discussing things like this. Note that the time has to be less than t by 4. Why? Because t by 4 is the time taken for the full amplitude. And for half, it must be less than t by 4. If the velocity were uniform, half of this distance would be covered in t by 8, because t by 4 is the time for this. For this, the time would be t by 8 if the velocity were uniform, but the velocity is not uniform. It is maximum here, minimum here. So, therefore, this half is covered in less time, this half is covered in more time, and the total time is t by 4. So, this half from mean position to the half is covered in t by 12, this is covered in t by 8, and the total is t by 4. I will show you this here. You see, this half of the amplitude is covered in time t by 12. The other half is covered in time t by 6. And if you add the two, you will see the time taken for this is equal to t by 4, because the total time is from here to here, from here to here. So, in the total time, it covers four such distances, one here, again again one there. And therefore, the time taken for this 1/4 is t by 4, for this 1/4 t by 4, for this half is t by 2, and for this full is t. So, we have the time for the nearer half t by 12, for the farther half t by 6, and the total is t by 4. So, like this, so we can keep on analyzing the system of oscillations. This is for a pendulum. So, in this lecture, we studied the oscillations, those special oscillations known as simple harmonic oscillations. And how do we recognize a simple harmonic oscillation? When the acceleration is proportional to the displacement and is in the direction opposite to the displacement, that is the signature, that is how we recognize a simple harmonic motion. That acceleration can be written as minus omega squared y, where omega then becomes the frequency of oscillations. And we have seen that during one oscillation, the energy remains constant. It is a sum of kinetic energy and potential energy, but the sum for one oscillation is always constant. In the next lecture, we will continue with oscillations. We shall use this expression A equal to minus omega squared y to find out if the given motion is simple harmonic or not, And if it is simple harmonic, what is the time period of this, or what is the frequency of this motion?